Hey there, Bruce, and welcome back to Game of Fourtune, Ultimate Gambling Survivors. This will definitely be the last episode of Ultimate Gambling Survivors because I believe we're about to beat Theresa as Devon, shockingly. But Devon's still trying to figure out what we're going to do with our request that we have now that we caught you cheating. So let's see how that plays out. First things first. Best to be aware of everything here. First, I want to see all the dice. The normal ones, the rigged ones, all of them. Theresa sighed and reached into her pocket before tossing out four more dice. One pair was a regular set of dice, and the other pair was another set of rigged dice. So in total, I had a pair of regular dice, a pair of 1-2-3 dice, and a pair of 4-5-6 dice. There was the bowl and the betting slip. And that was it. That's all I had to try and figure something out. Okay, I think I know my request. Alright, let's hear it. First, I'm going to make a bet, and I'm going to put all my credits on the 11-12 range. But before we play, Therese, you have to agree to some rules. You have to promise not to cheat again. Promise not to cheat? If you cheat again, and I prove you're cheating, then you have to give me all the credits I need in order to reach 1,000 credits with my group. You can't ask for any new equipment or supplies from Bell, and you have to use normal dice, no rigged ones, just standard dice, and have pips numbered from 1 through 6. I picked up two dice and carefully held them up to Theresa. If you try and use any other dice than the standard ones, then I'm gonna know. So you have to play fair. And those are the new rules I want. That seem reasonable to me. I'll allow them. Theresa stared at me, ignoring the device I was holding out to her. Just kept gazing, her gaze locked onto mine. It was oppressive. What kind of bullshit are you trying to pull? Huh? That's it? This is your big gambit? You got a chance to try and alter the rules of the game to give yourself an advantage, to assure yourself a victory. Is the best you can come up with? I winced and lowered my head. You're putting your life on the line for a 1 in 12 chance? And you think that me not choosing to cheat is somehow going to assure that you'll win? You've been using cheap tricks to try and beat me because you don't think luck is on your side. I bet you that it's not. Oh, is that what you think? You think the Lady Luck has forsaken me because I like to bend the rules a little, huh? I can assure you, it's the opposite. She loves it when people try and take fate in their own hands. Only desperate idiots try to call on luck to save their ass. But if you're proactive, she'll come and help you when you need it. I doubt it. Watch, I'm going to win this because you got bad karma. What goes around comes around. Theresa pounded a fist on the table. I looked up to see a familiar fury blazing in her eyes. Karma is bullshit. Good people don't have good things happen to them, and the wicked get away with a lot of shit before any retribution comes to them, so you can take your karmic bullshit with you to hell. She swiped the dice out of my hands and pulled the bowl over to her side. Oh, I'll enjoy this, watching as you preach about karma and all this nonsense just have to explode in your face. I closed my eyes and prayed. I needed this to work. Please, please. Praying that things will work out? You're fucking pathetic. If you got the balls to make a bet like that, then you might as well look up and see the results. Whatever, wallow away in your fear. See if I give a damn. I'll just look back at you once you realize your fate is sealed. So let's do this. Dice in the hole. For a moment, time seemed to slow down. I opened my eyes to see the dice slowly drop on the bowl and see the terrified expression on Theresa's face. That's it. She did it. Hole? Her body was paralyzed with confusion for just a moment. She was quick to recover from her confusion and reach for the bowl, but I was faster. I snatched the bowl and leaned over it to keep it out of Theresa's hands. Let go of it. Give the bowl back. You goddamn sneaky rat. Get off the bowl. I kept the bowl gripped on my arms. There's no way in hell that Theresa was getting her hands on this. You think you're so damn clever, huh? You think I wouldn't notice? Now get the hell off my bowl or else you're gonna regret it. I felt a blow against my face. I recoiled, but I kept a firm grip on the bowl. I said let go of the damn... Hands off. In a flash, I watched as Alphonse rushed over and decked Theresa in the face, sending her recoiling back on the floor. That's interfering. They're interfering with the game. Interfering my ass. She was attacking Devon. I'm allowed to keep my teammates safe. Settle down. Settle down, everyone. Good grief. You'll get so worked up so fast over the smallest things. Alphonse, go back to your side of the table. And Theresa, you so much as lay a finger on Devon again, you'll be pushing up daisies, got it? All right. But... Oh, did you want to go right now? Because I can happily oblige. I've been thinking about adding some new fertilizer to my garden. Without another word, Theresa stood up and rubbed her now bleeding nose. Sheesh, it's like I'm babysitting children. You alright, Devon? I didn't think Theresa would resort to actual physical violence. I'm fine, wasn't anything I couldn't handle. But I get her anger, or maybe more like desperation. She's done. She knows that she's screwed up. Really now? You pull a fast one I didn't see? If I was watching correctly, then yes. Let's see how this plays out. With Theresa placated and Belle watching over her like a hawk, I felt comfortable enough to finish my plan. All I had to do now was show it off. I took a deep breath and raised the bowl off the table. A 3 and a 6. A 9. Normally this would be a loss, a game over, an ending. But it wasn't, because Theresa cheated again. I picked up the dice again and presented them over to Belle. She tossed the rigged dice into the bowl. See? One is a 1-2-3 die, and the other is a 4-5-6 die. Belle took the dice in her hands and inspected them closely. I told her to use standard dice with normal pips, but she clearly used the rigged ones anyway. So I should, by default, receive all the credits I need to win. Huh? But when did... Shh. But Belle, it wasn't my fault. She made me take those dice. I didn't choose to use them, and I couldn't ask for new ones because of her bullshit rules. You saw her. She basically handed me the dice that I had to use. She basically forced me to cheat. You can't blame me for this. Forced you to cheat? Where'd you get a silly idea like that from? But she didn't say you must use the dice in my hand, did she? Well, no, she didn't. And the remaining dice are on the table, were they not? That's... If you wanted to get a legitimate dice, you didn't have to ask me for anything. All you had to do was reach across the table. So in my eyes, you deliberately used rigged dice when you had alternatives. Thus you cheated, and thus... Belle snapped her fingers and a pile of credits appeared on my side of the table. Devon is entitled to the winning amount of credits. I was in awe at the pile of credits before me, honestly, it wasn't a lot. But the sheer fact that I was able to get enough to win it all, I was surprised that just riling her up like that would even work. But she couldn't imagine someone like me coming up with a plan twice in a row that would beat her. Once, maybe. Twice? It was inconceivable that someone like me, that a bored gambling, would think of some way to trick her. Well, if she's going to prey on my weakness, then I sure as hell could take advantage of hers. And with that, we've come to the end of our game. Everett, Alphonse, Devon, you all managed to earn 1,000 credits and thus have won the game. Congratulations. Woo. Well, it took a bit longer than expected, but a victory is a victory. I'm just glad to be done with these stupid gambling games. And of course, for Theresa, go ahead, kill me. Not like it matters. She laughed, but I could still hear the sniffles and muffled sobs mixing in her throat. You think it matters that I lost? Well, yeah, at least a little. If I had my camera with me, I'd be happy to take a picture of that scowling, tear-stained face of yours. Laugh it up where you can, Alphonse. Laugh it up where you can. Because you're going to fail your little mission. You and Maria. Solid all of a sudden? Scared that all this hard work will go to waste? Maybe this time around I won't be able to see your faces twisted in agony and despair, but I'll get there eventually. And when it happens, oh, how I'm going to laugh until my guts are sore and my lungs squeezed empty. Maybe I should get in my practice now. Theresa began to laugh maddeningly, eyes wild with insanity echoing in the casino so loudly that it drowned out the idle sounds from the nearby slot machines. Good lord, she's insane. I don't even know what the hell I'm looking at. Quit the act, Theresa, and just accept your defeat with grace, won't you? Theresa stopped her wild laughing and quickly glared back at Everett. Grace? Why, Everett, is this how you lose with grace? With wild laughter? Have you ever seen what really happens when you lose a gamble with your life on the line? It's much more gritty, intense, and bloody. A flailing of limbs, violent sobbing and screams for help, biting and clawing at anyone trying to grab you. Oh, and the curses. People are amazingly creative with their insults when they're being dragged off to their execution. It's all very chaotic affair, but by contrast, mad laughter seems to be quite elegant, don't you think? It's unbecoming to see you like this. Is that a touch of concern, Everett? So you really do like me? I knew that eventually I'd be able to get a reaction out of you. All it took was dying in some stupid gambling game to make you show your true colours. And back to the standoffish silence. Oh well. Don't screw up, Everett. Without me around you, I've no one to blame but yourself if things don't go according to plan. I won't fail. You better not, or I'll be real sad when you come to visit me in hell. She let out a heavy sigh before leaning forward on the table and looked me square in the eye. And you, Devon. Well, you're going to curse me out now. I suppose I could. I suppose I'm more angry at myself more than anything. I just wanted to know one thing, though. When did you come up with that final trick? On the spot, my mind was just buzzing trying to figure out what to do. Can't say it was all that well planned. So you really did just come up with that on the fly. My, how nostalgic. Well, let's not delay this any longer. I've got an appointment with the Reaper, don't I? That you do, so let's not waste any more time, then. Belle snapped her fingers and Theresa winced as she looked at her arm. Ouch! You couldn't have something more comfortable? Guess you can't ask for comfortable execution these days. Despite her impending death, Theresa did nothing but smile, and eventually she started laughing as tears began to roll down her cheeks. A strange mix of sorrow, despair, and insanity as her laughter slowly died down. She collapsed on the table. Whatever was in her bracelet eased her into a slow, quiet death. But I could still hear that echoing laughter in my head, a lingering death rattle that made my entire body shiver. But at least now it was all over. Finally, we'd won. My body shivered and I could feel my skin crawling as I took a step away from the table. I'd won, but I still hated all these dumb games. How the heck does anyone get thrills from this kind of thing? It's just so... ugh. Thank God it's over. You're very much welcome. Belle clapped her hands and the bracelets on her arms fell to the ground. Congrats, with this victory you're all free to move on. The door is over here. With a wave of her hand, Belle carved a door out of the wall to allow us to step through to the next game. And now that we're done here, I'm going to go ahead and take my leave. After all, I got two more games to run. Toodaloo. Belle puffed away in a cloud of blue smoke and left us in this unsettling silence. Well, shall we get a move on? No parting words for your dead partner? Not even a sniffle or a tear? No, there won't be anything like that. Theresa and I knew what we were getting into, and we're not exactly close. I won't shed any tears for her, and I'm sure she would do the same for me. She sure made it sound otherwise, because she enjoys teasing if you hadn't noticed already. I'll make it clear, there's no relationship between the two of us. We're co-workers, and frankly, I wouldn't have had her along with me if I could choose. But it wasn't my decision to make, so I sucked it up and dealt with it. Maybe she just likes burly guys. I'm not going to wonder about that. Instead, I'm going to walk along and get to the next lounge. Devon, you coming? Yeah, I'm right behind you. I wasn't exactly expecting Everett to be crying or broken over Teresa's death, but I figured that maybe he'd at least send her off with some kind words. From what I can tell, he acts like he doesn't even care about her. Well, maybe it's not an act. Maybe he really doesn't care at all. It's kind of scary in its own way. We walked through the familiar hallway again, but this time I felt a bit awkward. Alphonse and Everett seemed calm enough, but they kept trading glances at one another. If not for the fact that I was between them, I felt like they might end up getting into a fight. That said, yeah, it might be handy having them tense like this. Keishi asked me if I could get information on their wishes. Might be easier to ask about something else first. Oh, I know. Hey, Alphonse, Everett, can I ask you something? Sure. Go right ahead. Earlier, Teresa said something about me being a plant by Connor or Sebastian. What the heck was that all about? Both Everett and Alphonse tensed up. Well, Everett, you want to explain what Teresa was talking about? It's not something I feel like talking about. Oh, you don't? But if you're going to be quiet about it, I'll go ahead and explain it from my point of view. Let's start with this. Devon, do you know how exactly the people got picked for this whole game thing? I don't really know, to be honest. I know that Clyde won some kind of lottery or got picked from some pool of people. And he needed a partner, so that's how I ended up coming along. I think Laura and Lilith got referred here. There was probably some others, but I can't really remember. That's good enough, really. Let me fill you in this way. Aside from maybe you and Clyde, everyone here was carefully handpicked to be in this game. At least that's what I'm guessing. Handpicked by those Digits of Eden clowns. The people in the masks, don't you remember them? I mean, it's kind of hard to forget them. Yeah, well, basically those four have the final say on who gets to participate in the game. And they do a good job of making sure that the people they put in don't cause any trouble. At least in theory. I don't feel like chiming in now, Everett. Just making sure you're not going to try and get any of this wrong. Have I said anything false so far? No, and I'm not going to give you the opportunity to either. Sure. Well, my point is that everyone here has been given a thorough background check and investigation. So why don't we run down the list of everyone then? First is you and Clyde. And though we already went over this, Clyde got in through a lottery system. I can confirm this. The Digits of Eden run a sort of lottery system to basically pull in random people in dire need of help. Clyde was lucky to get picked and in turn was able to pull you into this. I don't think I consider an opportunity like this, lucky? Well, regardless, you two are here, so now let's move on. Then there's Lilith and Laura. You said that Lilith got in through some referral or something like that. That's what I remember. That's not uncommon. The Digits of Eden get tons of requests and referrals from all over the world. Laura Orfeo is a respected member of the local community. Helping her would, in turn, help us reach out into others in need. At least, that was the logic used when her name was brought up. You're telling me that she was referred to this death game? Who in their right mind would be involved in something like this? Thousands upon thousands of people, if you'd believe it. You're kidding me. Well, I believe that's because a lot of people don't actually know what really goes on here. I mean, one look at Laura and it's pretty clear she had no idea what the hell she was getting herself into. As unfortunate as it is, there is a need to keep some of the finer details private. Not many people would be willing to participate in the Games of Fortune if they knew it was a death game. But that's not the heart of the matter here. The point is that Laura was allowed in because the leaders determined that it would be a good look to help her out. Let's see, there's Philip and his child Richard. Philip himself used some of his prior influence to gain a spot and bring his son along. Use his prior influence? Philip used to be a dear friends with Nigel and Kana. I believe this was a sort of one-time deal they worked out in advance. Hell of a deal to get yourself in here for a wish. Jade essentially bought his way into the Game of Fortune. Bought? Like, he paid money to participate in this thing? That's the meaning of the word bought, yes. There are various services that we offer. Jade wanted one of them and paid to jump to the head of the line. Is the line of people buying spots to be a part of this? Demon, you shouldn't be surprised at what people are willing to throw away for the sake of a wish. Usually we'd have more people like this participating in the game, those that have bought the privilege to be part of the game. But there were less slots open than usual, so he's one of the few that got in just by paying a hefty amount. Anyway, Jade brought along Grant, and everyone was fine with those two coming along. Their wishes are awfully predictable. Of course you'd know what they'd wish for. Well, if you know their histories, it's not hard to figure out. You know all the details of their past? Something of the sort. As I said before, there are extensive background checks done on every participant. But let's not get lost in the details now. After all, these next pair are the important ones. Kishi and Zeph were requested by Kana Umishima. Kana who? The woman with the blue hair and the blue mask. That's Kana Umishima. Oh. She's the second in command of the Digits of Eden, which is the reason why Kishi was allowed to participate. Again. Again? What, this isn't her first time around? From what I understand, this is the second time since the first time didn't go so well. The same goes for Zeph. It's not that that's much of a surprise when you consider that Kishi is Kana's granddaughter. What? Is that why Kishi seems to know so much? She must be getting spoon-fed info from her grandma. Yes, well, the important part is simply that Kana wished Kishi and Zeph to be part of the game. Or rather, she wanted Kishi to participate, and Kishi wanted Zeph to accompany her. Elizabeth and William came at Sebastian's request. Sebastian was the man with the white mask and the blonde hair. Okay, got it. From what I understand, Elizabeth was asking a favor of Sebastian to participate and brought William along. That old lady and Sebastian know each other? Indeed, though I don't think their relationship is as strong as it used to be. Nevertheless, Sebastian granted her wish, and thus she is here. Myself and Theresa were chosen by Nigel Edwards, the gold-masked man, to participate. We are his guardians, his protectors, insurance in the event of the worst-case scenario. Alright. You don't need to worry yourself over the major details of it, but know that we're here to keep him safe. Which brings us to the curious case of Maria and Alphonse. Oh joy, it's our turn. Can't wait to see what you have to say about us. Devon, do you know why Maria was allowed to participate? You said before it was because she was a great recruiter, right? Precisely, but there's a bit more nuance to it than that. Like? Well, there were many people useful to the Digits of Eden that we could have let participate. But at the same time, there was a considerable risk in letting her in. Nevertheless, the idea was floated around of allowing her to participate because it would show others in the Digits of Eden that great things can happen to those that are loyal and dedicated. Imagine someone like Maria who worked tirelessly to help us. She gets a chance to be in the Game of Fortune. That seems like the dream of many, and this lets the dream be more real for many members. Do you know who thought up that idea? Maria? Nope. It was Kana who brought up the idea. While we were finalizing out the roster, she brought up the idea of having Maria participate, much to my displeasure. I didn't know you were involved in who got in the game or not. I don't decide. I just offer my thoughts. I've been with the Digits of Eden for quite a while, and helped it grow into what it is today. But nevertheless, it was known among the top brass that Maria was harboring resentful feelings against Nigel. Oh really? Wonder what would have caused that. Regardless, Kana brought it up and it was obviously some plot. It may as well have been a blatant threat. Oh come on, that's a little harsh, don't you think? It's not hard to believe that Maria just wanted to bring back her mum's life to life, isn't it? You tell me, Alphonse. What's your goal here? I'm already certain of it, but I might as well hear it from your mouth. Yeah, you're right, there's no real point hiding it. I'm here to kill your boss. What are you going to do about it? Everett's fist balled up as he glared at Alphonse, but he didn't make a step toward him. I'll do what I was brought here to do. Keep him safe from threats like you and Maria. But since we're being honest with one another, tell me this. Did Kana put you up to this? Or is she truly just insane and senile? Alphonse suddenly got quiet and grinned. What do you think? Know this, Alphonse. I don't know why you're in league with that woman, or what she's offering you, but I assure you that she will suffer retribution for trying to bring down what we've built over these long years. You're in a lose-lose situation. If I were you, I'd rethink your goals here. Nah, it's a bit too late for that. If I could just ask a question again. If you and Maria are going to kill this Nigel guy, and he's one of the Digits of Eden leaders, then why didn't he just say no to putting you two in the group? Can he have just not taken the risk? Yeah, honestly, I figured that he wouldn't let us in, but somehow things worked out in our favor. Because refusing would look like weakness. Certainly, he could have come up with any number of reasons to not allow Maria into the game, but doing so would make it look like he was afraid. Afraid of that someone would come to get revenge against him and that they would succeed. So what? Better to be weak and alive than strong and dead, right? You'd think, but there's also a matter of pride. And hey, ultimately, if this foolish assassination attempt on his life fails, then he'll look all the stronger. A benevolent man who put his heart out to help people, only to be stabbed in the back, but still come out on top. Now, I like the narrative quite a lot. And also gives him plenty of reasons to reorganize the leadership in the Digits of Eden. I feel like I'm in the middle of some dangerous intrigue between feuding families. Ah, but we stayed off course from your question, didn't we? All this is to show that Theresa may have thought of you as a plant, or some kind of agent of Kana or Sebastian to advance their goals. I doubt that's the case. The only plant so far seems to be Maria and Alphonse. No, I mean, it's basically true. I see. We continued walking in awkward silence for a few more seconds until another thought popped in my head. I just realized that you never mentioned the guy in the green mask. Did he get a say in who got to participate? Cole. He was involved in an incident 4 years ago. Due to that, he wasn't allowed to be a part of the decisions for this year as a means of punishment for his actions. Otherwise, he'd probably have some kind of pair involved in this game, I imagine. I guess something must have happened 4 years ago, but that's not really that important, is it? No, what matters is that I got a lot of information out of this. Alphonse and presumably Maria want to kill this Nigel person, and we use the wish to do it. They got him because Kana, Kishi's grandmother, and Everett and Theresa will be doing everything in their power to stop them. If Kishi's alive, then I can tell her everything she needs to know, and then we can find a way to get out of here. I felt confident that things would work out. I just needed Kishi and Clyde to survive their own games. With Theresa dead, that meant only three more people could die. Clyde and Kishi are in the last room, so chances are they'll survive, right? It's cruel to think about it, but I really hope more people die in the second game. Devon, you coming along? Huh? Oh, sorry, I was just thinking about things. I understand that we've dropped a lot of information on you, but rest assured, it's nothing you have to worry about too much. These are just issues that we'll have to resolve as the game continues. Yep. I nodded and followed the two of them to the end of the hall. And just like last time, we entered the ever-familiar lounge. Once we entered, Alphonse walked over to the kitchenette while Everett decided to lounge on the couch. I simply stood awkwardly, unsure as to where I should go or who I should follow. Maybe now might be a good chance to ask Alphonse some things. I walked over to see Alphonse looking through the fridge for something to eat, and I pulled out a sandwich. Hey Devon, you want something to eat? Looks like Belle keeps this thing stocked up on, well, whatever you're craving, I guess. You were craving a sandwich? Can't go wrong with a pulled pork sandwich. He took a bite and then leaned against the counter. He's not wrong. Something you need? Aside from food or drink, I mean. Well, nothing really. Guess I just want to talk. There's only the three of us here at the moment, so I don't have much to do but think and, well, talk. And I'd rather talk than think about this situation we're in. Gotcha, well, if you want to talk, I can't say I'm the best conversation partner, but I'll try and make things somewhat interesting. Is it alright if I ask something about Maria? Yeah, sure. Though you're probably better off asking her. There's no guarantee she'll make it through a game. Guess that's true. Well, what do you want to ask? How do you know Maria? Ah, well, it's nothing really that special. Must have been probably 8 years or so ago when Maria's mother got in contact with me. Asked me to look into some shady stuff going on with the Digits of Eden. I met Maria through her mother and, well, frankly, at first we didn't really get along. Really? Yeah, she kind of thought I was trying to trick her mother out of money and that I was trying to make monsters out of the Digits of Eden. Probably because back then she was the favorite in those Digits of Eden. She didn't see the problem with it. But we slowly got on better terms as time went on. She didn't hate me as much and I started uncovering things. She began to question whether or not the Digits of Eden were really as great as she thought. Not sure what I'd call it. Back then it was like an uneasy friendship. We enjoyed one another's company, but it wasn't all that deep. Then about 4 years ago, well, that's when things got real shitty. May up and died, and Maria, well, I couldn't just leave her in the shocked, depressed state that she was in, especially since I felt that it was kind of my fault, something that Maria was all too eager to remind me of. It was rough the first few days after the ordeal, but eventually she calmed down. We talked, and we came to an understanding. After that, it was, well, I guess we got along better after that. That was a lot. It's a complicated relationship. Maria doesn't seem to make it look that way. You two seem to be on good terms. Well, we are now. I'm just saying, it wasn't always that way. And here we are, united by a common goal, I suppose. Killing this Nigel guy, right? Alphonse nodded his head. I wouldn't worry about it. It's just something that Maria and I have to do. I'll try not to worry about it. He nodded again and went back to eating his sandwich. Anything else I could help you with? No, I think I'm just going to rest up on one of the couches. Now's the time to do it. And hey, you handled yourself well in the last game. Thanks. Hopefully I'll never have to do that again. Alphonse chuckled as he continued to eat his food. I found a spot on the couch to rest my head and close my eyes. Not much else to do but rest. Time to rest and relax. I fell asleep quickly. Maybe it was just tired from the other games, or perhaps the last one took everything out of me. But now, I had nearly everything that I needed. I can get the information over to Keisha and I'd be able to get out of here with Clyde. I just needed them to survive. Survive. Shh, she's resting. No need to wake her up. I felt myself being woken up by voices. If I had to guess, some more people had arrived. Was it from the second group or the last group? I slowly roused myself from my slumber and rubbed my eyes to get a better look at who had arrived. Look at her, you're fumbling. Look at her, you're fumbling has woken the girl. All I did was lean over and ask how she was doing. What exactly would she be doing other than sleeping? Testing the comfort of the couches? Don't be a smartass. Elizabeth and Philip were bickering with one another, as usual. Is it just the two of you? Afraid so. Grant and William didn't make it through the last game. It just goes to show that youth isn't always a triumph over wisdom. If it was a matter of wisdom, you'd be among the dead as well. Oh, come on, you can't possibly think that I've made it this long without accruing some kind of wisdom, do you? I certainly can think it. Well, everyone's entitled to their opinion, I suppose. Anyway, Philip looked at me with a soft smile. Good to see you made it. Your game go well? I wouldn't say that. Trying to gamble against someone like Theresa isn't exactly a fun experience, you know? You had to gamble against that girl? Well, to be fair, it wasn't just me. I was just the last person to do it. Everett and Alphonse did most of the work. Oh, don't be so modest. You practically won the game for us, Devon. Everett had walked over to greet the two new entrants. That's overstating things. Ever the modest one, huh? I'm not modest. I just don't like gambling and I got lucky, that's all. Seems that Devon wasn't very fond of whatever game that she just played. Still, a victory is a victory. And truth be told, I'm a little relieved to know that I won't have to deal with Theresa. I felt like she was a real scary person to go up against. That's one way to put it. Philip and Elizabeth took a seat on the couch across from me, while Everett stayed standing. Have you been getting enough time to rest? How long ago was your game? I'm not sure, actually. We finished our game and then I went to take a nap. Hasn't been that long, I'd estimate around 15 minutes or so. I see, well you must be excited. You're halfway there, just two more games and you'll be right at the finale. Honestly, I feel more anxious than anything. Most people don't feel excitement from this kind of thing, you know. It's not to say that I'm excited either, but you know, it's better to go into the positive attitude than a dull one. If you go on feeling depressed, you'll end up ruining your chances. You're ever the optimist, aren't you? Nothing to it but to believe in it, right? Ah, Alphonse, I'd completely forgotten you were here. You're quite sneaky when you want to be, aren't you? Well, I just like to listen more than talk. Well, by all means listen in, though I don't think that we're talking about much of interest. That's so. Then do you mind if I borrow you for a few minutes? Please take him away. I've heard him talk for more than one lifetime. You really want me gone that bad, huh? Well, I suppose there's no reason to chat now, is there? Great. Let's go somewhere quiet. Quiet? There's not really a lot of space in here to speak in private, you know. I feel as though I'm about to be pulled in for an investigation. Anything that serious? I just want to ask you some questions. Alright, I'm used to answering questions. Philip stood up from the couch and walked over to the kitchenette with Alphonse. You know, you two sound like an old married couple. Ugh, please don't say things like that. I don't think I'd be able to stand a week in that as that old buffoon's wife. But you'd be able to handle it for about 6 days. Maximum. And then the glamour of his charm would fade away. But I see that you're still doing well for yourself, Everett, despite everything that's happened. Have you adapted well since the accident? I see you've chosen a new name for yourself as well. A new name? Accident? With all due respect, I'd rather prefer not to speak on the matter. It's not exactly a pleasant memory. Well, I'm sure that it wasn't. I don't believe most people can remember their deaths after all. Elizabeth, please, Devon's watching. Is it something she shouldn't hear? Well, it's not exactly that, but well... Everett shifted uncomfortably in his seat as Elizabeth spoke. Suppose it's not exactly a dire secret or anything. Excellent. I've wanted to speak with someone like you for a while now. This seems like the appropriate time to do so. If only I had my laptop with me to write down notes. Everett was sending me a pitiable look, one that screamed, please don't stay here for this. But this seemed interesting. I could listen in and figure out a bit more on Everett's history, and whatever this accident thing is. Or I could leave him alone and maybe see what Phil and Alphonse are doing. Maybe listening in on them might be interesting. I think I'll wrap this episode up because we're out of time for today. I think that's what I'll do. Mm-hmm. Although I really want to hear the Everett one. I'm going to stay and listen when we come back because that sounds interesting. But until then, we are done for today because we have no more time. But it's good to be out of the Ultimate Gambling Survivor game. Fun though it was, it kind of went on for quite a while. So it'll be good to move on and head towards whatever ending we're heading towards. I don't really know. Anyway, thanks for watching, Bruce, and I'll see you in the next one.